All right, so now we have, you know, with us a very young boy, you know, I can call him that, you know, because I have known him since probably his school days. So amongst us, you know, we have Mr. Siddharth Shah, who has, you know, a very successful, I would say, an entrepreneur. He is a founder and CEO of a company called Ascent Health, one of India's fastest growing healthcare distribution companies. Siddharth has also co-founded and established leading a $50 million health technology platform and continues to invest in improving healthcare ecosystems in the country. He was awarded amongst one of the 200 leaders of tomorrow from across the globe at 44th St. Gallen Symposium. Siddharth did his engineering from DJ Sanghvi College in Mumbai and an MBA from IIM Ahmedabad. He is an avid car racer, something that, you know, give me jitters. Having been at the National Karting Champion for 3 years, he actively volunteers for Jyot, contributing to digitization, indexing and analysis of Indian heritage and knowledge, bringing it to many people. So Siddharth is going to talk to you about this, you know, whether one should outsource pharmacy or not. So let me put it to vote before he speaks, and then I'll put it to vote after he speaks. How many of you think it is prudent to outsource pharmacy? Those who say yes, please raise hands. And those who say no, please raise hands. So there's a lot of them say not to outsource. Siddharth, up to you now.
I think the presentation will get loaded, but nonetheless, thank you so much all for being here. I'll just start with giving you a little summary about the overall industry and at least the way we see it. You know, Dr. Desai said, he's known me since I was a very young kid. My parents are doctors. My father's kind of been part of a couple of hospitals. I have no formal background in healthcare. I was an engineer before I went and did my MBA. But, you know, there are some facts and facets about the... you know, I'll come to where we are a little later. But let me try and give you a little sense in terms of the Indian pharmaceutical industry, and most of you would have a fairly good idea, but in a small nutshell, right? We as the Indian pharma, right, for as much as we are touted globally, I think we are touted because of the fact that we are extremely good in manufacturing and marketing, right? So the Sun Pharmas, the Lupins of the world are extremely well known. But if you actually look at the supply chain, we are completely fragmented, right? To give you a perspective, we have about 60,000 distributors in India and about 7 to 8 lakh chemists, which is phenomenal in terms of the fact that, you know, we have such high level of fragmentation today in the country. The top 10 distributors in India do not even have a 4% market share. The top 10 organized retail chains in India would hardly have a 4.5 to 5% market share. I'm not trying to say that this is a good thing or a bad thing, but I'm just trying to tell you the extent of fragmentation and breakup that there exists. If I just compare that to what is happening globally, right? You have in the US or in Europe, the top five guys making a more than 90% market share. Or similarly, if you look at even so-called emerging economies, it is a similar case, right? The top three, four, five guys would have 30, 40, 50% market share. Sound logic would always tell all of us that especially in a business which is involving any kind of logistics, any kind of buy and sell and purchase, scale is what matters. And the economies of scale today are absolutely non-existent today in the entire Indian pharma supply chain. With this background, ultimately we believe that it is the consumer, it is the hospital, it is the patient who is actually paying the high cost of this fragmentation in the industry. If you look at the whole channel, right, most of you might be happy to know or surprised to know, if you buy any product, an FMCG product, right, if you buy an Ayurveda product of Patanjali, for example, on an average, you'll see a retailer getting about a 10% margin at the very best. You'll see a distributor or a sub-distributor, as the case may be, making about a 4 to 5% margin. Pharma is one of the few fields where actually the margin goes to as high as 35% in case of a normal trade. And I'm not even talking of hospitals. If you look at a typical pharma industry value stack or margin stack, right? If you look at, if let's assume the sale is 100 rupees, out of that 30 to 35 rupees is what is going to the channel, that is to the retailer, distributor, C&F. Another 20 to 25 rupees is what the pharma company typically spends on the education of the doctors within their different various forms of CMEs, as we would call it. Another 10 to 15% typically is the cost that a pharma company will incur on the cost of its medical sales rep. And the cost of manufacturing a drug or a product is actually as low as 10 rupees on an average. So out of the 100 rupees, broadly if I have to put it, 35 rupees goes to the retailer, stockist and the trade channel. Around 35 rupees is spent behind the MR and the CME programs for the doctors. It's only 30 rupees which gets left behind with the pharma companies, out of which 10 is their cost and 20 is the profit. If you look at the whole thing from the perspective that if you were to consolidate the whole market, right, this is just to give you a sense in terms of, in fact, Indian pharma is doing much better than global pharma. The top 10 players in US have only 33% market share. The top 10 Indian pharma companies actually have a 42% market share. But if you look at the distribution and retailer, the whole thing is completely fragmented. And this is the share of the top 3 distributors alone across the world. I'm only trying to say that the channel, as it gets more and more and more fragmented, the cost of doing that typically comes at the end guy, which in this case, be it a hospital, for which pharmacy becomes a very critical source of a profit center, or at the end of the consumer, right, in the whole scheme of things. So as you keep on moving, I think in our new age economy, there is a phenomenal drive for consolidation. That consolidation becomes more and more imperative as the trade barriers that exist in the country, with more and more FDI coming into play, inability of small and medium guys again to try and keep up pace, try and keep up inventory. For example, you know, it's surprising that in our country there are about, on an average, people say there are about 1 crore prescriptions written every day. However, you'll be surprised to know only 60% of those prescriptions are completely fulfilled. There is a 40% bounce rate. And, you know, by a poll of hands, how many of you have ever experienced going to a pharmacy with a prescription, or if you are a doctor, you've written a prescription and the patient comes back, ki doctor sahab, ye 10 mein se 8 dawai hai, 2 dawaiyan nahi hai. Can I know by a show of hands, how many of you have faced that problem saying that, oh, I don't have this medicine, or the chemist says, sir, main aaj nahi, kal deta hun. That is again a problem of fragmentation. And now we see, as more and more, hopefully, younger people, younger entrepreneurs, and more modern technology comes into the whole scheme of things, we see things coming together. With this background, I'll give you a little background of what we do as a company, and then I'll make my case. So, Ascent Health today, in a span of the last three and a half years, has tried and gone ahead and consolidated this fragmented supply chain in the country. In simple words, we've created a pharma distribution presence across the country, everywhere as you see, and we've become, in about 3.5 years since formation, it says 1000 crore, but we're almost at a 1200 crore run rate. We represent roughly 1% of Indian pharma. But in simple words, we are like, if you would call it the Amazon or the Flipkart of the pharma, but not for the consumer, for retailers, for hospitals, for doctors, for service professionals. Within this whole scheme of things, right, we have a tie with 350 plus pharma companies where we act as an authorized distributor, stockist for them. We have our own warehouses spread over, you know, lakhs of square feet across India at all these places, ensuring that whoever is the end customer, right, which is today at this point of time more than 15,000 retailers or more than 100 hospitals, get access to the same product at the same uniform pricing across the country. So now if I move ahead and I give you a little sense in terms of where does the whole thing stand for the hospitals, right? If you look at any hospital in terms of why should it look at outsourcing, right? I think the first thing that everybody will look at is what are the economics, right? The economics, and all of us over here are smart enough to know that if, for example, a hospital is buying goods worth 10 crores, vis-a-vis there is somebody who's buying the goods worth 1000 crores, it's but obvious that someone who's buying goods worth 1000 crores has a much higher leveraging and a negotiating power with the respective pharma companies or with the distributors or the suppliers, as the case may be. We at Ascent have actually turned this model upside down. When we go to these retailers and when we go to these hospitals and we go and tell them that, hey, by the way, if for example, on a sale of 100 rupees, you are making 40 rupees, why don't you plug into our system with a simple pricing model where we tell them, if you are making 40 rupees and the price on my platform, and I will show you my landed cost is 50 rupees, why don't both of us just split the benefit equally, right? So you make 45 rupees instead of 40 rupees, and I, because of my scale, end up making 5 rupees for the entire investment, technology, warehouse and the setup that I've got. But basically you keep on adding, right? Let's say there's the first hospital that gets added, we are now 1010 crores. There are 5 more hospitals that gets added, we are 1050 crores. So it is basically leveraging the collective power of each and everybody that is in this room, going together and doing a bulk buying, right? That is essentially what we are doing. But it does not just stop in terms of the economics. I think the second part is more now in terms of regulatory compliance, right? We've seen that, I'm sure most of you are aware, there is a new pharma policy which is coming in place from 2017. There is a lot of pushback coming on to the entire hospitals in terms of clinical establishment rules. There are ethical rules and policies coming in from pharma promoting to doctors and doctors taking those, and FDA policies, right? For example, if most of you have seen, draft policies have just started. Draft policies will now allow online pharmacies in India also for the consumer. So now when you look at the whole thing in toto, right, somebody who can help you with the generics push, somebody who can help you with the regulatory push, somebody who can take care of your entire operational excellence. I think in this whole scheme of things, your costs get distributed and it makes sense, at least from what we've seen with some of the people to partner with us, right? Needless to say, when an organization that comes from an established perspective, you bring in the best of your systems, you bring in the best of your paperless pharmacies. I would actually like to, you know, perhaps as a breakout session, once we are done with it, give you a demonstration of a product that's been developed by our team. It's a product called as Docon. It's a product that is India's first paperless EMR system, right? So EMR by definition can be of two types. Either you have somebody who is typing in the computer, or today's day and age we have used digital pens where you write down, but none of them are truly digital. We've actually developed a tab based approach which is touch and tap based with a global pattern, and I'll actually take you through that. But all of these things that we implement, right, we've had an opportunity to implement this across the length and breadth of the country. And if I give you a perspective in terms of case studies, we are the exclusive supply partners to the entire Manipal group of hospitals. For more than 75 years, Manipal hospitals have been managing the pharmacy by themselves. But now we've come into place, put all the systems and processes together, and we've seen for a hospital of Manipal scale, a 4% improvement in their margins. If you look at that from a overall perspective, a hospital like Manipal does hospital sales at an MRP value of anywhere close to 180 to 200 crores. A 4% improvement is a direct improvement of 8 crores to their bottom line. Or an example like Nanavati BL Kapoor Hospital, right, where we've actually seen an improvement of more than 20% in the margins of the hospital from the day that we came in till the day we are now. And at all these places, we are completely compliant with the FDA. For example, at the Radiant Hospital, we've actually integrated and developed systems where things become paperless. So there is a terminal or a tab, as I said, at the ward. From the ward, it gets indented, comes to the pharmacy. The pharmacy is completely barcoded. The products get scanned at the barcode level. They get indented to the patient. At the time of dispensation, they again get barcoded. So, you know, there is zero medication error. I'm sure most of you are aware that in India, more patients die due to medication error than terrorism put together. Right, so that's the extent of medication error that happens in our country. So if you look at all these things put together, you just come to a paperless pharmacy, 100% barcoded, automated solutions, the time to check out for the patient at the time of discharge, all of that gets improved. And these are just some case studies that we have in place for us. So I don't want to take you through more in terms of, you know, theoretical benefits. I would actually appreciate, because a lot of you are actually skeptical in terms of saying that it should not happen, I would actually like to throw it open for Q&A and give you some examples or some scenarios in terms of why it happens, what happens, and how exactly does it happen. So thank you so much. Yes, doctor. Right.
Generic prescription is being, pushed now. So how does this entire thing work?
So I think as we move towards genericization, right, there are two elements. So let me give you a little legal perspective in terms of what we interpret as the law and then how I see it happening in reality. So the law today says that the doctor must write the prescriptions as far as possible in the generic format, right? So the legal people believe that it's a must. The doctors believe that it is optional. If the medicine is written in a generic format, it is actually the pharmacist who, along with the consumer, so the pharmacist is supposed to educate the patient and the consumer, and they together are then supposed to decide whether should it be brand A or B or C, right? Or should it be a pure play generic drug? Now the question comes, what if the doctor has still written the brand? It's a violation of the code per se in the eyes of the government, but even today the pharmacist is not allowed theoretically to substitute the products that have been written by the doctor in the prescription. So there is no remedial mechanism in the event something has been written in terms of a brand. So this is the legal position. How do we see this thing now coming into the actuality, right? So the way we see the whole interpretation and the industry moving is that more and more pharma companies are going to put a lot of their focus on the channel vis-a-vis the doctors, right? Globally, companies like Glaxo have faced flak where their CEO of the China business was actually jailed for a couple of months because of the regulators' perception that they are influencing doctors in a right way or a wrong way. We are going to see more and more pharma companies keep their focus on the channel, which means hospitals. They believe that by tying up with hospitals in terms of a bulk deal, by saying that you will have products of X, Y or Z going ahead, right? And putting in place digital systems where the hospitals will now start having mechanisms where the prescriptions will be written in generics, it will be more like a collaborative approach, right? In fact, the models that you are coming into India are more driven again by what's happening globally. So there are pharmacy benefit managers globally, the largest amongst them in the US being Express Scripts, where typically if you've seen any Hollywood movies, you will see that they always get the medicines in the amber pack. It's because the doctor will write the prescription in a generic format. Depending on your insurance and your ability to copay, you will find medicine of X value, Y value and Z value. I think we will slowly and slowly move towards that format. But at the same time, this is also going to consolidate the pharma market in terms of big getting bigger. That's the way we see it. For example, if tomorrow, let's assume in a futuristic scenario, the brands get eliminated. Now I'll only have paracetamol. I'll have paracetamol by Sun Pharma. I'll have paracetamol by Lupin, or maybe I'll have paracetamol by Siddharth. Chances are people will say, let's buy paracetamol by Sun Pharma. Because those are the companies that people are aware of. Today, as a consumer, me and you, as a patient, is not actually concerned whether the product is by Sun Pharma or Lupin or Cipla or Glaxo, because essentially that decision is taken by the doctor. But as things keep moving ahead, that the onus of that will come to the consumer and the channel. And that's where we see the next big growth coming in.
Can I have a follow-up question?
Sure.
If suppose the branded formulations basically die out, if that's exactly the scenario, where do you see the margins? You talked about 45% margin, and typically we see 40% margin in a hospital pharmacy. Where do you see the margins going to a hospital?
Suppose
it becomes a generic play.
If it becomes a generic play, we expect those margins to go in excess. And I don't want to be quoting names, but we've seen hospitals that are working within the branded space, still buying products only from the top 50 pharma companies of India. But we've seen large case studies in the multiple hospitals that we work with where margins have gone as high as 55, 56, 57%, right? So I think the 60% barrier is not too far away.
You do IPD pharmacy also?
Yeah. So these numbers are for IPD pharmacy. So as a company, we engage with everything, the whole spectrum. So surgicals, IPD, OPD. So there are people who can come and become, they can just buy products from us, but with the hospitals that we have, especially, it's more like a complete turnkey management of the process, right? So we'll come in and not just provide goods for you, but we'll enter into an entire formulary management. So for a meropenem, right? So whether you buy meronem or you buy X or Y or Z, right? Today you may be buying something which is best for you, but that may not necessarily be the best across the whole spectrum, right? So we will even advise you on formulary management. We will execute that. And so it's not like a theoretical exercise where I'll say, oh, sir, your margins will go from 40% to 50%. But we'll actually put that into action and roll it out for you. Yes, so we have both models. So we have models where the hospital can continue to have their own pharmacy. So for example, if it's a, whatever, let's say it's a Nanavati hospital, the pharmacy is called Nanavati Hospital Pharmacy. The pharmacist and the sales guys are from Nanavati Hospital. But we come in and just take over the purchase function. So the purchase manager is from our end. We have an SLA where we say that you'll have a 99.99% availability, which means only 1 out of 10,000 products will get bounced. That's our guarantee to you. And if anything gets bounced, it's our responsibility to ensure that it's available in 24 hours. Right? So we'll put in place those SLAs, but the entire purchase function is then taken over by us. And obviously the pricing and the revenue share is taken over by us. There are also models where hospitals have come to us and said that we don't want to manage the pharmacy at all. You know, you keep not just the purchase function, but even the operations under your role, and then we take care of that as well.
There was a slide which said 3,500 SKUs for a typical thing. Do you see the SKUs coming down? Because if suppose you are handling the back end, then the front end of prescription could also be brought down into specific formats, even if it is not generic. So the SKUs coming down, would the margins climb up?
So in some sense, right? So we manage about... So as a channel, we manage more than 45,000 SKUs today. But on an average, we've seen the inventory come down for hospitals where we've gone in by efficient formulary management. And again, what happens is because, for example, you are based in Mumbai, just hypothetically, and we've got 4 warehouses and fulfillment centers, right? As a hospital, if earlier you were working, A, we'll reduce your SKU count from, let's say, 8,000 to 4,000, just as an example. And number two, even within those 4,000, you will not have to actually stock up for 20 days. Because the worry is, what if there is a stock out? But for you, there's no worry of stock out because we have a 25,000 square foot warehouse, which is acting as a central node for everybody, right? And there will always be 20 days of reserve stock kept on our books. So you win in two ways. You win not just by rationalizing the SKU count, but also the number of days of inventory that you have to carry is also rationalized to a significant extent. So we've seen hospitals actually reduce their working capital by as much as 60 to 65% as part of the overall process, but maintaining still the 99.99% SLA in terms of the fulfillment.
We have been having another model of operations for quite some time. Our hospital buys approximately drugs for 40 crores an annum.
Sorry?
40 crores an annum. Per year.
Okay.
See, the arrangement with our, if we have outsourced it, the arrangement is, we have given around 2,000 to 2,500 square feet of place within our premises for the supplier. He has to stock medicines worth of, the inventory will be around 1,500 to 1,800 only, not more than that. We have our drugs committee, now and then we keep changing. We have a policy that we'll have only 3 brands in every drug, not more than that, and all that. With all this, he stocks the medicines. Every day, whatever the requirement is there, it goes to his online, it goes to his place. He keeps supplying it. Every weekend, we make the payment. That is, we are free to see all the invoices, 100% of invoices, anytime scrutinized. And the margin given to him is only 4%.
Right.
That's the way we operate. Right. This has been going on well.
Right. So, sir, I agree with you, right? But the question is, for example, let's assume, again, at 40 crores, let's assume for a moment that he is making a 40% margin, hypothetically, right? Which means that he's buying your, so which means that the 16 crore is the margin that the guy is making. Which means essentially he's buying all your products at 24 crores. Again, just as an example, right? At 24 crores, you are saying that you'll only load 4% on the pricing. You will see all the margins. So 4% of 24 crores, let's assume for the sake of argument, that's 96 lakhs. Right? So he's saying that, sir, I am buying at 24 crores, I am selling it to you at 25 crores, and 40 crores is the sale that you are doing. However, one factor that we are missing out on, right, that we've seen with most of the pharmacies, that 24 itself might not be the right benchmark. You are adding 4% on 24 is the right thing. That's a very fair arrangement in terms of that, you know, as an O&M guy, I'm making a certain percentage. But what if the base itself can be brought down from 24 to 20? That is the big jump that we are seeing by most pharmacies coming in, right? So let's say the person who's managing the pharmacy today on your behalf, or you are managing it, your purchase today is at a 40 crore level. Vis-a-vis when we are managing at a 1,000 crore level, our ability to negotiate with the pharma companies is far better, and hence we are able to bring that 24 itself down to 20. And the benefit between the two is split, right? Now one can decide that how should the benefit be split, right? I can say that, oh, it's my work, and you know, I can say the reverse thing, that sir, I'll bring a 4 crore benefit, should I give you 1 crore out of it, 2 crore out of it, how should we split it? Should the guy still manage, should I manage? But the point is that every single time that efficiency keeps coming in, and our belief, at least I can say with 100% success rate, because we just don't manage for private sector hospitals. For example, we actually did a comparison with the price at which the medicines were procured in the government of Gujarat. Okay, and I'm happy to share that we are the single manager at the back end for all the Deen Dayal Jan Aushadhi stores, right? So the reason, again, I have a very good insight on generics is because the government has launched the Jan Aushadhi program. There are about 150 Jan Aushadhi stores in the state of Gujarat, and we are the single supplier to the entire state today. And these are hospitals which are in the largest civil hospital in India, which is Civil Hospital in Ahmedabad, to the Civil Hospital Sola. So every medical college, every district hospital, every sub-district hospital, we are in a position to manage the back end, right? So again, you can think of it this way, that you may be, you know, a 10 crore hospital, a 40 crore hospital, or a 100 crore hospital. You'll now actually get the rates that we are able to get for the government of Gujarat, right? So that's the benefit that incrementally you stand to get when you become a part of the network. So again, sir, as I said, there are two elements. So our warehouses that we've set up across India, those are on our licenses. In your hospital, we give you both the options, as I said. You can continue with your license. I will just put in place a purchase manager who will buy on your behalf, and you can keep on selling. Or we are also in a position to say that we will lease out that said premise from you, take the license on our name, and hence we are responsible for everything. Your entire compliance, GST, we are responsible for everything. So we offer both options. So thank you so much. Thank you so much.
That be on stage, you know. So I like, you know, Dr. Shashi Balian to felicitate Siddharth. Siddharth, he is also a doctor. He has ventured into setting up laundries. Thank you so much, Siddharth.